everyone. I'm Dolly from Delhi, and today we are meeting some of the most talked about members from, roll please, Indian Matchmaking. Love it, ya hate it, we all have binged it in one go. And the internet has so many questions. Whatever happened to Nadia and Shekhar, Aparna or Jay, Vyasa or Rashi? Did any of these jodis finally end up together? What do they think of matchmaking now? Is it a bit dated, or is it still a ray of hope for the singles who feel they're out of love and luck? And what's the scene with Akshay's mom's blood pressure? I'm here with some of your favorites to answer these questions themselves. Get ready for Indian Matchmaking Catch Up. This person kicked up a storm online with her Bolivian salt flats requirements, and honestly, I'm just excited to see what else she has to say. It's Aparna. Hi Aparna, how's it going?
Good, it's been a roller coaster over here. I'm really enjoying it.
Was there any incident, any message that you got or any email that you received that really overwhelmed you?
Yeah, I've actually gotten quite a few from women who are in relationships that they want to leave, or proposal situations where they're just not comfortable. And they said just seeing me be so unabashedly myself made them think that maybe they could speak up for themselves. For the few women that said that they were in these relationships they wanted to leave and that they'd been thinking about it, they said it would be a good example for my children, if I have any, or for other young women, if I left this situation. That's such a powerful big moment in their life, and the fact that they connected or related that to Indian Matchmaking or anything I said is just so powerful and so overwhelming. I mean, it literally sometimes brought me to tears. I'm reading my DMs sometimes with tears in my eyes, and I never expected that. That's really something that surprised me.
No, of course. I think the best part about you is that you're so clear in your head about what you want, which a lot of us have a hard time with. So that's actually very inspiring to see you doing that. You know, you're like, okay, this is what I want, this is what I want, this is what I don't want, and I don't want it. But on a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you hate comedy?
Bad comedy? A lot. I hate it a lot. I hate it at a 10. Good comedy? I can enjoy. But that's the thing. It's very hard to find really good comedy. I've found it a lot through this Indian matchmaking process. People's memes are cracking me up. There's a lot of bloggers that are doing some really creative videos. Maybe it's because I was a part of this project, or maybe because sometimes it's about me, but I find it really funny. So I don't think that I'm opposed to humor, but I just think that overall, a lot of people are not funny, and they think they are, and they're not.
Okay, perfect. In your, you know, journey, we were left with the last date that you had with Jay. What happened after that? Are you guys still together, or did it not work out?
So Jay and I are still friends. We did not ever start any sort of relationship together. We had such fun that day. You can see that in our interactions. You can see that with the goats. And yeah, it was just a special experience. And we still talk every day. We text back and forth. I still talk to Dilip every day. I talk to Shekhar every day. So the men I went on dates with are who I really call my friends today. And for me, that's so special, because we got to walk away, you know, with these friendships, and that's priceless, really.
There is also one episode where you mentioned, why do you have to relax for 10 days? What is your take on that?
So I actually have a pretty relaxing life. I know it's surprising, but I am not a workaholic by any means. I try to balance out my work and my life. So even if it's a full day at the office, I'll still come home. I'm an auntie. I like to go for like 2-3 mile walks every night. I like to make my dinner. My family is very close by to me, and we all live in Houston. So we see each other. Back before COVID, I would see my friends. So I don't need to run away from my life and escape. I don't need to relax. If I have that time off and I want to use it to see beautiful new things and new cultures, I know that's not popular, I guess. I guess a lot of people like to sit on the beach for 10 days, but I sit in my patio every day. I don't need to go sit on a beach. So that's just another preference of mine. It's the way I like to spend my 10 days. Like I said, we don't get many holiday days in America. And if I get 10 days, I'm going to do something marvelous with it, like amazing, wondrous.
Okay, so Aparna, we see that there's a pattern in the show where the men and women are treated kind of differently when they reject a proposal or take their time with it, while men are said to be of higher standards, or, you know, they are taking their sweet time. Oh, they have just rejected 150 dish, so it doesn't matter, I'm gonna give them 40 more. But women, even if they would reject one rishta or, you know, just two, They would be called stubborn and too picky and not flexible enough. Do you have something to say about that?
I can't speak for the culture and the society as a whole. I can speak for Sima. That's who I worked with. And watching her in the process, I definitely think that she takes her background and her understanding of the world into the process. And that makes sense. That's what we all do every day. And so to watch her with Pradhuman, tell him, it's okay that you've seen 150 girls. Here's some chocolates that I'm going to bring you. And then to watch her with me, where she says, you're negative, you're stubborn, you're all these terrible things. I think that's very strange and very concerning. And that actually gave me a little pause about, you know, the process and how this was going to look for me, even at the time, not knowing that she treated, you know, Pradhuman and Akshay differently. In fact, I thought it was very interesting when that one contributor, I think his name was Vinny, he allegedly didn't show up or something for a date and, made Nadia very upset, which was very hard to see for all of us. Obviously, as fellow women, we don't like to see our girlfriends upset. But it was interesting what Sima Aunty said about him. She said, oh, he's just unsure. I was like, so people can just not show up to see other people and they're unsure. But the minute I'm sure about something, I'm stubborn. I don't know. It was a little weird to see on camera. I've never faced that before. I am in my 30s. I have built my family life around my relationships with my mother and my sister and my brother-in-law. I've built my friendships. I've built my career. I've built my side hustle. I've built my political views and, you know, all the ways that I view the world. And I'm going to meet the person now in my 30s. And they're going to come to me with all of those same things that they built for themselves. I don't expect to meet a man in his 30s and for me to be like, I'm voting for this person. If you don't want to vote for them, we can't be together. That's not the way it works at this age. We're not 19 years old. Now, if we have to compromise on the place that we live, well, then yeah, we have to compromise on that. And if we have to compromise on, you know, the way that we want to raise a family one day, then sure, those are conversations we have. But I would never ask somebody to change themselves for me. And I would hope that they would never ask that from me either.
I think now stubborn to me has become a compliment because let's all be stubborn. Let's all, you know, be clear on what we want and ask for it.
I saw a hashtag from a young woman the other day and she said, be like Aparna. And I was like, that's the sweetest thing I've ever heard.
I think your intentions were great, Aparna. Thank you so much for having us. He may not be a man of many words, but I hope he has a lot to say today. Meet Akshay. How do you feel after the show has aired?
Oh, it has gone crazy. I've been getting so many calls. My phone's been buzzing. It feels good also and kind of weird also because yeah? People have very strong opinions. So I really don't know. I'm having like a mixed reaction to it.
What's your opinion though? How do you feel?
I really like the show. I mean, there was nothing wrong with it. It was pretty good. Obviously, it was a bit cringy. That's why people have, you know, stormed the internet with it. But it was a fun show, man.
Okay, so going forward, there was obviously your engagement that we saw happening, but we also heard that it broke off. The engagement is no more there with Radhika. Are you comfortable telling us what happened?
Oh yeah, of course, I'm totally comfortable. So what happened was, I mean, you might have seen the entire show also. A lot of things are going on in my head. First they shoot and then we're looking, parents telling me this. I mean, so much was going on. And I met the person. I mean, we were talking. I mean, not really talking to, but just trying to talk. And then it went on. Then the ritual happened. The entire night, I couldn't sleep. I'm just like, what is going on with my life? Or what am I supposed to do? You know, I can't even hold a conversation with this girl for 5 minutes. So how am I supposed to spend the rest of my life with this girl? And that just kept going on in my head again and again and again. I really can't do this. Like, my mom and dad, like, what do you mean you can't do this? What are you talking about? So I was like, I can't marry this girl. So why? So it's because I can't even talk to that person for 5 minutes. It's not that something wrong with the person. I mean, it's just that we are completely two different people. Everything's just opposite. I can't see myself spending my rest of my life with her.
Okay, that has come as a shock. And I think even for our viewers, this will be a shock considering how much pressure was on you initially, like what we saw on the show, that you had so much pressure on you to get married. So now that if you're telling me that now you don't have any of that pressure going on and you are completely free to choose whoever you want to and fall in love, how do you feel about that?
I feel really good. Since the day I opened up and I told my parents about it, it's like a whole burden coming out of me. I feel so free. It's so good. You know, it feels just really nice.
Okay, Akshay, so now I'm going to talk a little more about the show and what we saw. In one of the episodes, you and your mom are in the kitchen. She's making the tiffin for you, you know, packing your breakfast. And she happens to say that, you know, your wife should come and do this now, that she's ready for your wife to take over. Is there anything, like, people obviously have thoughts about that whole statement? Yes, you have something to clarify here?
People have taken that completely wrong. It was supposed to be a funny scene because the way it starts, she's cooking and I'm just talking to her and she's like, oh, when are you going to get married? And then like, oh, if you get married, your wife will probably do this for you, do that for you. So she was just teasing me. People have taken that to a whole different level because if you see the end of the scene, it's supposed to end with the BP machine showing the blood pressure.
Yeah, but how is your mom doing? How's her blood pressure now?
Her blood pressure is completely fine and she's pretty normal now. I'm telling you, the day after I told her and everything happened, she's like, mom, I'm not happy, then why to do this and all. And she's like, okay, beta, your happiness is our happiness. If you're happy, we are happy with whoever you are. And there's no, if she's below 5'3", that's cool too, you know.
Akshay, there's also one line that you say in the show that you want your wife to be exactly, you know, like your mother. Is it still true? Do you still hold that thought or has that changed in a way?
Again, people again took that, you know, in a very different way altogether. Not exactly like my mother. What I meant was qualities like my mother's, few of the qualities which I feel like should have, and I mean everyone has, you know, a few qualities like their father or a few qualities like their mother, qualities like she's so supportive and caring. That's what I actually meant, you know, not exactly like my mother. I got a lot of hate for that, man, and I've been seeing some kind of complex they are showing. I never even knew about that. I was freaking out. I'm like, why are people saying such things? You know, what I meant was qualities.
Speaking about backlash, there's also another point that you said, another thing that you said in the show is about when Radhika made it clear that she wants to work. And right after, we had a clip of you saying that I want my wife, future wife, to be at home and taking care of the kids. And how is she going to do that if she goes out and works and, you know, has a career? What about that?
So before, when she asked me, I was like, yeah, man, that's completely fine. If you want to work, that's cool. I just wanted to know, what about the kids? You know, how you're going to, because it doesn't have to be extreme. There has to be balance in life. I mean, work also, what about kids? Because I know what I'm supposed to do. She never asked me, you know, how are you going to take care of the kids? If she would have asked, I would have probably told her. But when I told her, I never got a reply back from her that, you know, how it's supposed to happen. And she could have just very well said it, you know, that no, I want to do this. It's completely fine. In fact, my mom was working. Bhabhi works too. My mom stopped working like 10 years back because of health issues, you know, she stopped. So it's completely fine if the girl works.
But let me ask you that question then. How will you take care of the kids, Akshay?
Who, me?
Yeah.
Oh, I really don't know, probably. So it's completely, I mean, I'm going to take care of them, like, probably, you know, whatever they do, help her in the night. I know when usually kids wake up at late in the night, take care of them, start, if they start crying, take care of them, grow them up, you know, I mean, that's how I'm going to probably try to become a good father to them, become a role model, which is a long way though.
All right. Thank you so much, Akshay, for joining in. And now we have someone who we collectively fell in love with. I am blushing. Are you too? How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I am also good. But like I said, we all fell in love with you on the show.
So sweet. I'm so humbled by that. It's so, so nice. The outpouring of love.
Was there anything that you saw or you received as a DM or something that made you really happy or emotional or something that caught your eye?
Yeah, I got a message from a friend of mine, and her best friend is Guyanese. And she sent me this message and she said this, she's like, guys, everyone has to watch this show. She was like, this is the first time I've seen representation in my life. And she was like, I'm shook. And that really touched me because I'm so proud to represent Guyana and our, like, Indo-Caribbean community on such a huge platform.
So your next date happened with Shekhar. Shekhar was the next man you met and you went to Chicago for that. And we were left with a cliffhanger. We don't know what happened after that. Please, please tell us what happened. Are you guys still in touch? Are you in love? I mean, I have too many questions.
We are not in touch anymore.
And shortly after, you know, the filming ended, we did talk and date for a little while, but, you know, the stars were not aligned. One of the best dates that I've ever had. So it was great. And, he's a great guy.
Yeah, I think so too. He is actually a super nice guy from what we saw. Are you still into matchmaking, even if it's not through Sima Aunty?
I am still looking for love. I'm not opposed to the matchmaking process. So I'm open to it.
Of course. But have there been any DMs or any, I mean, I should say thirsty DMs as well? Because I think we all fell in love with you, men, women, everyone. So I'm pretty sure you must have gotten those nice or maybe some upfront messages like that.
The messages and DMs, some thirsty, some not. Let me just put that out there. I've gotten proposals. I've gotten people, you know, saying, let me take you on a date. Let's have a FaceTime. I'll treat you right. And I'm like, this is all so, so nice.
But was there anything that you wanted to take forward? Were there any prospects there?
As of right now, no. I haven't come across any messages, but, you know, maybe there's one that's hidden somewhere deep in there that I haven't gotten to yet, so we'll see.
Men, if you're listening, if you're interested, please. The matchmaking process as a whole has been, it's been debated and it's been controversial. People have called it regressive, which I agree. What is your take on that? Because you were a big part of this process and you decided to go ahead with it.
Now, especially with our generation, I think it's a little bit different. Yes, there was a lot of controversy around colorism and profession and age and caste and this and that. But at the end of the day, we still had a choice. And I think that's something that was important to highlight, was that I wasn't being forced into this. I wasn't being put into anything against my will. I had a choice and I made that choice. And I think arranged marriage, I think, might still be a thing because it's so easy. Like, you know, anyone can be a matchmaker per se. Like I can introduce you to my friend. And then if you guys, you know, get together, then I'm a matchmaker. But, you know, I think what Sima Aunty does is so much deeper than that. But I think maybe our generation might be the one who's going to hopefully change the views on the matchmaking process and bring it a little bit more modern and a little bit more inclusive into what's happening right now.
Yeah, I think so too. I think if anything else, it's also a big lesson for us to take those steps and probably become the change that we wish to see in the world. The second date happened with Vinay. It went great. You all connected like as if you were long lost, you know, soulmates or something. I mean, at that point, we thought that and we were all rooting for you guys. But are you guys still in touch after that all? Like you guys drifted apart. We got to see that and you were pretty upset about it. But have you guys connected after the show has released or after the dates?
We have not connected since then. I, you know, really have been standing up for myself. And that this was one of those moments. And, you know, aside from us being, you know, recorded on screen, this is my real life and this is the date and this is my experience. And so in real life, if a guy, you know, did this to me, I would react the same exact way. This isn't any different because of the cameras. So you treated me poorly and I, you know, don't deserve that. And I'm not going to engage any further. So that was just kind of that.
What's up? Okay, so he just gave me some lame ass excuse that he's not coming.
No! You okay?
This episode where Nadia broke down and she was very upset about you ghosting her. When you watched that, mm-hmm. What were your thoughts?
I mean, obviously, when I'm watching that episode, like, it upset me a lot because to see like the reaction amongst like especially amongst a female audience like that I was getting was kind of like hurtful, because there's obviously two sides to every single story and I definitely made some mistakes, but I'll own up to any single mistake I make. So all I'll say is that there's two sides to every story, so never just necessarily try to judge a book without by its cover and like try to understand a different perspective. Like I think that's a 2020 motto, like try to make sure you listen to both sides before judging. And I have the truth in my eyes, like I know what happened. She knows what happened. And like, I'm never going to discount what she believes or what she thought, because like, that's her truest feelings. And like, but I have my truest feelings too. And like the truth to me was that I did mess up. I owned it. But like the fact that I said that I had ghosted her and ditched her twice, that really hurt me because that didn't happen.
I think there is also a little confusion between what actually happened between you guys and who ghosted who. Is there anything that you want to say about that?
Can I say no?
Have you ever ghosted someone? I mean, I have done it. I don't want to accept it, but in some ways I have. So have you ever done that?
I will say that I wouldn't necessarily call it ghosting, but I will, which is not any better for the record. Like, I'm not saying I'm like holier than thou, but like I'll do like what I call like a natural fizzle, which is where like you're texting for a while and then like the texts get like longer and further apart, and then like it comes like a day to like a week, and like every other week, and like, oh sorry, I've been really busy. And then like, to me, like I don't mind when I get the natural fizzle, because I was just like, it's just a nicer way of just like kind of being like, this wasn't really much of anything, it's not really going anywhere, so let's just like let it go.
Well, that's 21st century dating, my friends. You fizzle it out or you ghost.
The natural fizzle, I'll stamp it now.
Brunch dates can go either way, but they're definitely memorable. Just ask Guru.
But I don't drink.
Okay, Guru, so how was the date? Was it as awkward as we saw on the screen? What was your, you know, like, let's hear you out.
So I can be awkward sometimes, but I own that awkwardness. Hopefully I'll learn how to be less awkward if I am. But some people were like, dude, you weren't awkward. My mom was like, you weren't awkward. She's so supportive all the time, which is great. How the day could have gotten better. One thing I'm working on is my posture, because some people felt that I wasn't sitting up straight. Some people felt that I catfished Nadia because I had a clean shaven face on the date and I should have had a beard on. So I'm working, as you can see, I'm working on the beard as we speak. It takes a lot of work to work on a beard. Just kidding, it doesn't. You literally just have to wake up and the beard is there. Actually, going on dates on video and then putting it online is a great way to get feedback. You just have to have strong skin, because some of it can be pretty tough.
Yeah, definitely. What about your fashion game? What's up with the wrinkled t-shirt that people suddenly have a problem with?
First of all, I didn't realize you're supposed to get t-shirts ironed like to that extent, but clearly I was wrong about that.
So have you been in touch with Sima Aunty? Are there any matches that happened that we don't know about, or anything that you're still on?
It would be great to say hello sometime. She seems really busy though. I think her business is booming, as DJ Khaled says. Because even like a lot of my friends are like, do you have Seema's contact info? Because my mom wants me to connect with Sima. So that's nice. I mean, the funny thing about that is that was a girl who had liked me, and now she's like, yo, can you connect me with Sima? And I'm like, great, that's out the window.
Where are you now? Arranged marriages? Is it a yes or a no? Or are you completely off that now? Do you want to meet people organically, or would you still consider an arranged marriage?
What I agree about with arranged marriage is that there's more of a seriousness to it, which I think is cool. And sometimes when you're on Hinge or any of the other apps, or as Hingy, as they say in the Shah Rukh Khan song, I don't know if you've heard that. Yeah, I mean, totally, I'd be down for it. It just depends on the criteria, and maybe I'd do it in private next time.
Okay, next up is the man we all loved as soon as he chair rolled into our lives. Hi, Vyasar, how are you?
Hi, I'm doing very well. Thanks for asking.
We saw you tweeting about your DMs that are coming in, flooding in, I would rather say. Are there any DMs that in particular really surprised you?
People are so creative now because they understand that it's a kind of creepy thing to message someone you don't know. So they try to use comedy to lighten how they slide in. It's funny too, because like with girls, overwhelmingly, girls are trying to, you can tell that they're trying to like make it quick and fast. Like, hi, I think you're really cute, bye. Or like, hi, I saw you on the Netflix show, you're cute, bye. And they're just, it's like, if they say it fast enough, I won't notice it, or I won't notice how creepy it is, which is cute. And with dudes, it's almost the exact opposite every time. It's like this long essay that just reads like, bro, you're such a king. Oh, we loved you, man. Yo, my mom loves you, man. Like, it's always stuff like that. And then, of course, there's lots of people who feel really empowered by what I was sharing about my father and feel like, you know, they can open up to me and talk to me about their stories and everything. It's really nice to see that. I'm not going to respond, but it's still really nice.
Yeah, obviously, definitely. That was, I think, one of the most heart-touching moments of the show, where you opened up so beautifully and it made you look so vulnerable, but you owned it completely and you shared a story like that with all of us. And we really appreciate that, honestly. But what made you take that decision to actually, you know, you also told your friends in front of us on the camera, you told Sima Aunty, you told the world about it. What made you do it?
Well, it was with my friends, with telling my friends about it, I was surprised that they didn't know because I could have sworn I had actually told them already. But I, you know, the story is old. It happened 20 years ago, you know, when I was a kid, and it doesn't, for a long time, I didn't feel like it had a very impactful presence on my life, but it is still part of my history and it's still part of my story. Being a creative writer, being someone who's invested in storytelling, you got to be able to tell your story. You got to be able to share your story. And more than anything, too, it's not a secret. Like, it's a court case. It's a matter of public record. Anyone can go online and look for it. So it's either, you know, you either choose to have control of your own story or you choose to have someone else have control. And I opted for myself.
Definitely. That's a great decision. And you made sure that anyone who comes into your life knows about it. Because honestly, there are people who try to hide things, and you can say court cases are pretty much open, but you know, the world is not as probably honest as you are. So you decided to tell Rashi, obviously. Did that actually happen? What was her reaction if it did?
What I can say is that it wasn't a factor for Rashi. Like, when Rashi did find out about it, it wasn't a thing that she cared about. It wasn't a thing that her brother cared about or that her family cared about.
Okay, but you two didn't work out really.
Right, but not for reasons related to what I told about my father's story. Part of it is just, you know, Rashi has never had a serious relationship before, and a lot of this was overwhelming for her. Being on camera is overwhelming in general. I think that we both still have a lot of growing up to do in different ways. She's at the beginning of her career. She just finished vet school, so there's a lot of new things on the horizon for her, and she has a right to try all of those things before trying to pursue anything else, which is where she's at right now.
You also mentioned in the show that a shared ethnicity for you is very important. Do you still hold that thought, or has it changed in any way?
That's a tough one. That's a really good one. It's something I've definitely been thinking about more and more because, you know, within my own community, there are not a lot of single Indian women running around. You know, you're not just dating to have fun. You're also dating to see, like, what the potential long-term things are. When I think about the long-term, I really want my partner to have a shared ethnicity. You know, I really want there to be some things that we have in the background that are common because it creates the space for deeper understanding. When you have a lot of these shared things in common, you don't have to explain it to each other. Like, I don't have to explain what the Shera is. I don't have to explain what Diwali is. I don't have to explain what a Bindi is. I don't have to explain why we, like, wear shoes that have curly things on the end of them. You know, like, all of those things that people ask questions about. And it gets exhausting. You get very tired of being the poster child for your culture. And it's hard.
And I think as an NRI, you already do that like every day. So to have that happening in your own home can be difficult.
Yeah.
Although, will you be open to, I mean, if something happens, if you actually fall in love at first sight with someone?
Dolly, I'm a romantic. I wear my heart on my sleeve.
You know, like, yeah, I knew it.
if something happens, something happens. You don't get to control who you fall in love with.
Like, when the world actually opens up and you go to these Indian, you know, weddings and functions and back to your work, I think it's going to be pretty different.
It's going to be, yeah, it's going to be a really different. I actually, one of the people who sent me a DM was this young Pakistani guy whose family had been watching the show across the world. His family is scattered all over the world. They were watching the show together and they were having like a big video chat after the end of the show with all of the cousins to talk about it. And he said, it would be really great if you just dropped in and said hi in the middle of our conversation. And so I did. I like just jumped on the video call with them, said hi, and they were all freaking out. And I got invited to 3 or 4 weddings because of that. So next year, you know, fly to Toronto for a wedding, which is going to be exciting to people like Barrett, who I just met over a video.
Oh my God.
I know.
Yeah, you've made friends all across the world.
Yeah.
That's brilliant. I mean, that's the best thing that has come out of the show. I mean, forget the memes. You've got connections, real connections now. Wherever you go, you have someone there.
Exactly. I always have a couch to sleep on.
Next, we have a man who dabbles in all things creative. Food, jewelry, clothes, you name it. His amuse-bouche isn't the only amusing thing about him. It's Pradyuman. How are you doing, Pradyuman? How's it going?
I am super excited to be here. And my experience has been exhilarating till now. The journey has been so beautiful.
I think the fox nuts that you made, the peri peri fox nuts, were a big hit. They are a big hit. Did you ever think that they're gonna be so huge online that people are gonna pick on that?
It's gone to another level. Like, people have trolled it to another level. I'm like, guys, no one had fox nuts before, or what was it like?
But I think it's the liquid nitrogen that you put in there that made it all like, oh my god, that could happen too. But also there have been a lot of comments about your lifestyle and, you know, the portrayal that has been on camera and everything that we saw. Do you have anything to say about that?
Guys, I think I am as a common person as everyone over here. I don't eat fancy food every day. I have pretty much my paneer every day. I'm just another regular guy, okay, having a lot of ambition and trying to grow as a person every day.
Coming to the next question, Pradyuman, is that you went on a very good and nice date with Rushali. I think we all saw you all kind of bonded, and I think from the previous date that was a big difference. So that went with Rushali went great. What happened after that, if you're comfortable telling us?
I've never done this like on camera, and we both were like, you know, just really nervous. Please excuse, like, if you know we're going somewhere wrong, and like that's where actually we connected. And we did speak after that as well. But later both of us realized that, okay, you know, we are at different stages in our life. At the moment, she was looking out for a modeling career. I was looking down to settle down in a way. And we had differences in terms of distance. I think this is one of the places where we had a little bit of difference. And I totally respect that.
Oh no, it totally makes sense. In the show also, Sima Aunty said that you have been quite, like you've rejected over 150 biodatas. And do you think you were being too judgmental at that point? Or do you think you do have that kind of standard that you want your partner to be that way, and that's why you rejected that huge number of rishtas?
Okay, I'm so glad you asked this question, Dolly. Let me first clarify. When you presented a biodata, in a normal sense, it's like, are you interested or you're not interested? It is very similar to how we open a dating app, right? There's so many girls, let's say, that have been presented on the dating app, and then it does not mean that if you're clicking a no, you're rejecting the person. It just means that you are not interested in meeting the person. Similarly, coming back to the matchmaking process, so you're presented with these options, and then you decide that, okay, I'm interested in meeting this person, and then the matchmaker goes and then they will find out about the person and they'll back channel verify, and when both the parties are interested, then they exchange numbers and then we speak and then we meet. In that whole process, I might have met like 5 to 7 people, but as I said, they had given me, like, I was presented with 150 biodata, and which is clearly misunderstood. And yeah, like, the memes are lovely, but
no, I think the comparison that you've made between a dating app and being presented biodata is lovely, and I think it makes a lot more sense now. But in the show initially, you mentioned that good looks are really important for you, that, you know, you should be attractive. Has that changed in any way, or is that still the same?
See, good looks is the first form of attraction, and then it is definitely the mental attraction which becomes the main form of attraction, right? It's like, you know, you buy a good looking mobile phone, but if it's not working very well, the mobile phone is not going to work, right? It's not going to sell. So in a similar way, when we put it to human analogy, okay, everyone, the first attraction for anything is always a physical attraction, and there is a mental attraction, but the mental attraction forms the basis of holding the whole attraction portfolio together. If I make sense, I'm not sure.
Okay, Pradyuman, it seems like another talent that you have is creating analogies, first with the dating app and now with the mobile phones. Now we have the lady that women like me, all of us, related so hard to, and I'm very excited to meet, Ankita. Ankita, how are you? How's it going? And I'm so glad I met you.
I'm just going with the flow, like how I was told in the show to go with the flow. That's exactly what's happening to me right now. I think I'm going to have to really find a lot of more drawers in my house to keep away all this love and support I've got from the entire world. It's been really overwhelming.
Oh, I can imagine. We all love you, just so you know. Was there anything in particular you saw? Because there are so many memes and tweets and everything that is going on around the show. Was there something that really caught your eye or made you emotional, or someone who messaged you?
I received a message on my WhatsApp from an unknown number, and I was really surprised because the first line said Indian matchmaking. And I had no idea how a stranger has my number on their phone. I opened my WhatsApp and I see that the girl had written, "Hi Ankita, I saw you in Indian Matchmaking and you might not remember me, but 3 years ago, you and I bumped into each other at Eye Candy in the washroom and I was crying and I wanted to end my life that night. You stuck around with me for an hour till I didn't smile. You took me out, you made me have a drink, and then you force-fed your number into my phone." And this particular girl still remembered me from that 3 years ago, man. And for me, it was everything. Then I didn't care X kya bol raha hai, Y kya bol raha hai. For me, it was Nena. Nena said this to me and that was it.
Okay, Ankita, that I think that was really beautiful. I almost got teary-eyed. Thank you for sharing that with us. There was also a moment where your dad mentioned how ahead of your times you are in the sweetest way possible. How did you feel hearing him say that?
To be honest, I've always had very open parents and I have a very open lifestyle at home. How I would talk to people in public or how I would talk to my friends is exactly how I talk to my parents. Like, I don't have layers to me. Like, I can't have layers to me. So, but I've always felt that my parents don't understand me at all. Now, what this show gave me was that when I saw them on screen speaking my language for me, I understood that they actually say certain things just to protect me. But they actually do think of me the way I see myself in my eyes. And for me, that was probably the most emotional moment on the show. And for me, that was like, thanks, Mom and Dad, for being who you are and for making me this woman today.
You were also the only person on the show who got two matchmakers, Sima Aunty and Geeta Aunty. What was it like? And it was all happening on camera. Do you think all matchmakers are essentially the same?
I think the matchmakers are a product of the environment, right? They're like that because people demand those atrocious things of them. I may not totally agree with the matchmaker's thought process, but as a business, I understand that is their bread and butter. So they also may not be those people, right? But they have to do it because they have to also earn and fend for their families. You know, when everyone walks up to me and says the show is so regressive, my only comment to them is, yes, it's extremely regressive, but it's also the reality of our society. So we can either look at it negatively and be like, why the hell is Netflix airing this? Or why did they even have to produce a show like this? Or look at the show and say, hey, there's a problem. And now we can make that change happen. So it's all on us how we perceive it.
Also, there's a whole lot of unhealthy emphasis on, you know, the whole concept of compromise, especially when it comes to women and them getting prospects. You know, we're told to be flexible, we're told to compromise a lot in a lot of aspects. Do you think there is any value to that, or are you completely against it?
No, I'm not completely against it. Like I told Geeta also, before you go into a compromise with anybody, a conversation is very important to weigh the pros and cons, right? Sometimes what that person might be doing may not be completely a pro for both of you put together. And this is not just for a life partner. This is for a friend, a parent, a business partner, anybody.
Yeah.
Without compromise, no relationship exists. This is a set. Like, you know, there's always a give and take in every relationship. But it requires a talk.
But that has to be equal for both men and women, right? It's not just the women's job.
Yeah.
Do you think it really helped you meeting the life coach and talking it out?
She was somebody who was not a part of the shoot at all, right? She was the third person completely, an outsider. So getting her perspective on it was great for me. And I think it also kind of helped us break the barriers of reaching out to people when you have a mental health issue.
That's very true. I think this whole thing about life coaches and therapists, I think we have to normalize that. And I think that came out well. Okay, but are you still in touch with Sima Aunty?
Sima Aunty and I just happened to talk 2 or 3 days ago. And my friend and I had planned a small live session for her because we were like, too much hate she's getting. Like, you know, let's just like see who she is as a person. So we had a small live session with my friend for her. And she felt great after the session. And she called me up to say that, thank you so much. I wish you had made me meet this girl earlier. Her smile is like sunshine. And yeah, that was it. And then, yeah, Sima Aunty and I realized we both practice Buddhism. So we were just like chit-chatting about that. And yeah, that was it.
But are you going to get any more matches from her now?
Sure, why not? I mean, if they fit my non-tradition modern value system, yeah, definitely.
That's amazing, Ankita. Thank you for joining us. Well, that was a long one, but I definitely enjoyed talking to all of them and listening to their side of the stories. And of course, it comes such a long way from the show. But whose side are you on? Vinay or Nadia? Do you really think Akshay and his family have changed so much? Will there be a season 2? Do let me know your thoughts. And of course, Indian Matchmaking. Love it or hate it, you've got to watch it. See you next time.